Well, I was sitting, waiting, wishing you believed in superstitions. Then maybe you'd see the signs. But Lord knows that this world is cruel, and I ain't the Lord, no, I'm just a fool. And I'm loving somebody, don't make them love you. Must I always be waiting, waiting on you? I sang your songs, I danced your dance, I gave your friends all a chance. Putting up with them wasn't worth it.
Hey, mate.
Hey, mate, how you going?
How you going? How's it, sir?
Oh, fantastic.
Henry.
I'm Diggo.
Pleased to meet you.
Didn't you play tennis once?
Yeah, a long time ago. I wish I could serve like you.
I make a surfboard for you.
Really?
Yeah.
You sure I can do that?
Sure as you can.
Okay, I'll teach you tennis if you want a little bit, no?
Sounds good to me.
Let's go surfing now, everybody's learning how. Come on a safari with me. Come on a safari with me.
What are you doing?
Surfing, that's what it is, that's what I do.
Like you wake up early in the morning, you go, you
check the surf first thing you do.
You don't even check the coffee first.
Oh, no.
Surfing first. Coffee.
I love
life,
it.
Sex, everything later. Surfing first.
Can you teach me or?
Well, I'm going to, because the waves are really good now,
okay.
I'm going to go for another surf.
And
then how about in a couple of hours, I'll meet you at my factory and I'll show you how to make a surfboard. Then I might even be able to show you how to surf.
Oh, okay.
How's that?
Okay, mate.
Once you start, you won't stop.
Uh-oh, I'm in trouble, even in my age?
You won't be going back home, you'll be staying here surfing.
Oh, then I better call my wife and kids.
I think you better ring your wife.
Yeah, I think I better ring, okay. So why don't you go and surf?
Okay then,
okay.
Thank you.
Okay, see you, mate.
Good day. Sunday, music, oh yes, I'm surfing,
Hey, Henri.
Hey.
Hey.
How are you, mate?
You found the place.
Oh. How are you, mate?
Beautiful Fresnes fumes.
Yeah. How's
great,
everything?
Isn't it?
Good.
Good.
So,
good.
Listen, I don't know anything about surfboard. Could you tell
you
me?
You don't know anything?
No.
Well, you've come to the right place.
This is how we start.
Well, the customer comes in.
Yeah.
I get an order form. I write down measurements that he wants. I know his weight, where he surfs, whether he's experienced. Then I get those measurements. And I mark them on the board.
Okay.
Put a ruler, tail, middle of the board here. Then I get templates and I draw up the board. So I have this outline now, so I know what he wants. I know this is going to suit him. And then if this was for you, it'd be bigger. So I know that you'd like to surf on it.
Okay.
And then after this, I cut it out and then I hand shape with the tools and the hands and finish it off. It's too easy.
Yeah, so easy. Too like easy. A tennis racket. What are you talking about?
And so here we have the finished product. And this is for extra performance. It's like a,
really?
You know, like a boat hull
bottom
to make it faster and more performance for good surfer. So that's what
so
this board's
for. Definitely not for
Definitely
me.
Not for you, no. So for you, we'll make something bigger, a little bit easier to
and
use.
And what are you doing after that?
After this, if there's no colour, it goes straight over to get fiberglass put on it.
How long does it take?
It takes about 15, 20 minutes.
Really?
And then he turns it over, does the other side the same. Once that's finished, into the sanding room. We could have you on a board within a day.
In a day?
Yeah. Go on, Henri.
Go?
Yeah.
French touch.
reef, dance on the bayou. That's how rhythm was born. They praise the mighty forgiver. They wash their sins in the river. Cold water makes more shiver.
Colors,
that's
how
rhythm was born. Folks came down and gathered around. That's what he showed. Put the praise and sang his praise.
Jackie, so what's your life? What's your background? Background? Yeah.
Both my parents were born in Lebanon. Yeah. I was born in Brisbane. My mum came out from Lebanon when she was 5. Then my father didn't come out until he was 21. Oh. Yeah.
I said, what's going on after that? So you're born here and then...
Born here.
School, everything.
Went to school in Queensland. Brisbane, Queensland, yeah. And I left Brisbane when I was 21, moved to Sydney.
For what, modelling?
For modelling, yeah. For modelling.
I just don't know why. I figured out. It's amazing.
You're amazing.
Oh, amazing. I can see that, you know.
So I stayed in Sydney for 6 months and then from there then moved to Melbourne. So I moved to Melbourne just before I was 22. Started modelling when I was 19.
Until?
And then until...
yesterday?
Look, I worked... Not yesterday, you're kidding. No, I worked until I was probably 30.
Yeah,
because then I fell pregnant. So around 31, because I fell pregnant around 31, did a little bit of modelling while I was pregnant.
Yes, still.
But then was producing fashion parades. Yeah.
Okay, and then what's... Okay, you had a baby.
Then I had Joseph. He was born in 2011.
Mm-hmm.
And then I went and studied psychotherapy for a year. And while I was modelling, it never really... stimulated me mentally, so I always did lots of work with different organisations like Very Special Kids or Big Brother Big Sister, Reach Youth, and I did lots of voluntary work there, which I loved.
Oh, you love that?
I love that, yeah.
Let's go back to your parents, your dad, and what happened, tell me.
Well, my father left when I was 16. And he left the family because he actually got busted for drugs. Back then, it was the biggest drug haul at the time.
Really?
Yeah, in Queensland.
And of course you didn't know.
No, God, didn't know anything. Came home from school one day and the house was wide open and all the furniture was pulled off the walls. And I rang my mum, who... My parents had a fruit shop, and my uncle answered the phone and he just said... I said to him, I think we've been robbed, because I thought we were robbed because the piano was thrown over and everything was sort of thrown everywhere. And anyway, he said to me, Jackie, don't use a phone, it's drugs. Your auntie's on the way home. And so that night I saw on the news, we sat there and watched the news and they had arrested my dad. And it was hard. It was really hard because my mum... they didn't have a very healthy relationship. But it was the thought of not having someone there. She felt like, how am I going to raise 5 children on my own?
5 children.
She had 5, and one was a Down syndrome. My brother's a Down syndrome. My father was a very strict Lebanese man. So a part of me wanted him to go, and a part of me wanted him to stay. And then when he left the country, I sort of blamed myself because a part of me used to pray and go, oh, I wish he would leave, because he was very, really, really strict and...
Very, really tough.
Very tough.
So what happened? So he went to prison
he skipped the country before... because he was...
He left the country?
Yeah, he was given life in prison and skipped the country. So he went back to Lebanon and remarried. And he was married for 6 months, and then he died at the age of 55.
Gee, that's a good story to start life, huh?
Yeah, look, you know, for me, I'm okay now.
I don't think I'm... let's going on and then what happened?
Yeah.
What happened after that?
Well, in my life, I was in the modelling industry, and I met John. And he used to own a company called Esprit Australia. Yeah. He was my second boyfriend ever. And I think I was craving a father figure because he was 20 years my senior.
He was 20 years older than...
20 years my senior. Yeah. And we were together for 2 years. And he also died.
Of a heart attack?
Well, no, they found his body wedged under a jacuzzi seat. He was getting lots of death threats because he had a great company, a clothing company, and then with that he created this organisation called Esprit Cares, and it was to help the underprivileged kids.
Yes, of course.
Working with a 15-year-old girl who was also a prostitute, and he had given her a job in the warehouse. And John was receiving threats from the pimp. So they don't know. They don't know. It was inconclusive how he died. But we had split up a week before died.
And then you split up and he died.
Yes. Yes. And that was shit. Then I got married.
Finally.
I got...
Happy marriage.
For nearly 10 years.
10 years.
Yeah, and then we separated. So we got married in 98. I had Joseph in 2001, and then I had Samuel in 2003. And then Jim and I separated in October of 2008.
Okay.
2008, and, yes. And then my youngest son, Samuel, he was 5 at the time, in August of 2009 was diagnosed with a brain tumour.
Okay.
And
he died?
He died 9 months later of April 2010.
It's how you handle that? How you do that? Huh? Jesus.
For me personally, how I handle that is because he was so incredibly brave. I mean, he knew that he was dying. We had the conversation. Actually, Perry was there when we told him that he was going to die. And he was incredibly accepting of that.
Yeah. And incredibly strong.
Incredibly accepting. And when he slipped, the day that he had slipped in and out of consciousness, it took him 18 days to die. And he was the one that led the way for us. Initially, you know, as a parent, your role, is to protect your children. And when he was diagnosed, there's nothing you can do.
No.
You can't say you're going to get better. You can say if you try, if you fight. And he said to me, I don't want to fight, Mummy. I don't want to fight. And how I deal with his death is I ask myself, what gift can I give him? And the gift I can give him is to try and live a joyous life in honour of him. And I keep saying, what would he want? What would he want? And he would want us to live a joyous life.
Yeah.
You know?
You are an example for a lot of people, for myself, first of all, and for a lot of people, love and respect. How can you do it? Most of the people just, you know, want to go away, want to kill themselves.
And, you know, I understand that. I understand that.
But you're still here, darling. You're still fighting. You still, when I came, you know, so you're like the sand on the beach, you know. You're so beautiful and you're just so... you're amazing.
I go back to love and to be loved. And I know it sounds so cliche, but I have always lived my life like that. And Sam was loved and he loved in return. And he was so accepting. He was so accepting of his death. And he's still with me, just not on that physical plane. Yes, I want to touch him and smell him, and I see kids of his age and I wonder what he would be like. Of course, all those things go through my mind. But I have to go on, you know, like I have Joseph and he struggles. It's difficult for him because he's asking questions like, well, why did he have to die, Mummy? Why couldn't it have been some 100-year-old man who killed other people? Why did it have to be Sam?
Yeah, I know, it's always... Yes.
You know, he talks like that and he sometimes wishes that it was him that had died. And then he's gone through stages where I found him behind his bed where he's sobbing and he's going, I want to kill myself, Mummy. His biggest nightmare is if he wakes up and I'm not there, or Shep's not there, or Karch is not there, and then he'll be alone. And I can't say to him, don't be silly, that's not going to happen. Because he's experienced death so closely. So we sit and we talk about that. What would he do if that did happen? So he has phone numbers in his
book
and he has
phone,
things to help him sleep. He has to take deep breaths, which is near his bed, so he looks at that and he tries to soothe himself. And the grieving process is so it's long, yeah, and it's long. Different for everybody. You know, for me, I believe, and I have to believe, that there is life after this life. Because I'd go crazy. I have to believe that he is flying free and he is free of cancer and he's not in a wheelchair and, you know, he can play football and do all those things. You know, Joey doesn't believe in that at the moment.
He's probably too young and is also afraid, you know.
Yeah, absolutely. It's only recently that I can really honestly say that I'm feeling moments of joy that are seeping in, if that makes sense. Like, I actually feel joy. And it's been such a long time, because I'm very good at, okay, if I have to go to work or if I have to, you know, with the kids, you know, you can't be like this all the time, and you learn to just function.
Function, like sometimes like a machine.
Of course.
You just switch off and you're, okay, I do it.
Yes.
I have to go. I do it.
Yeah. Shit.
What are you doing now?
No, I'm doing counselling and I love it. I absolutely
counselling. You means counselling?
Counselling, like a psychologist.
Psychologist.
Yeah.
Okay.
So
that helps you to throw that away again, or to listen to someone has problem, or
there's always someone who is worse off. And in terms of studying and becoming a counsellor, to me, I don't see it as listening to people's shit. I get inspired by listening to somebody else, and I'm fascinated with how they learn to cope. And everyone copes differently, and everyone deals with things differently. And it's actually very nice not to have to think about your own shit. But you know what? I think we expect to live until our old age, you know, where we just assume that. But it's not necessarily the case. And I think when Sam was first diagnosed, and it's, you know, 3 years after his death, I'm so thankful to have had him for 6 years. I'm so thankful. And it's taken me a long time to get to this place.
It was just, what can I say, amazing. It was really nice. Thank you.
You're so welcome.
Oh, thank you,
very
my love.
Welcome.
Oh, I'm so happy to meet you. So nice. Thank you.
And I wish you well. Thank you. For everyone, everybody. Okay?
Thank you so much. Have a safe trip home.
Ah, I'm trying now. Yeah, I'm trying.
Enjoy the rest of your trip.
Yeah, thank you very much. Bye. Thank you. What can I say? Just I met someone just unreal, unbelievable. So I have nothing to say about it. Two dogs and two men. How are you?
Good,
nice
thanks.
To meet you. What is this?
Well, this is the sunroom. When in the winter time, the sun comes through here and it's bloody fantastic to sit out here. It's really warm.
Yep.
And this is the engine room. This is
Could you show me the engine room,
this
please?
Is where it all happens in here, right?
Oh, really? Everything happened there.
Well, almost. Maybe. And this is our kitchen.
If you just sit down here and you
look see the view.
Okay, so what time is it?
It's beer o'clock, of course.
It's beer o'clock. So let's go for the beer. I mean, it's probably you don't have enough beer here.
No, we don't really, but anyway. what would you like?
Give me a beer.
They left me here. They left me here.
They left you here with the mask.
Maybe you can talk. Henri, what's amusing us is your accent.
And my love, what you've been doing? What are you doing? You, I don't know.
I'm a personal trainer.
Really?
Yes. Well, he
wait,
should be.
You haven't told me.
Do you need one? I will not charge you. Know. I'm really willing to go for a run with you.
Go for a run with me?
Run let's like go.
Well, that's it. I met some amazing people and I heard some great stories. It's been unbelievable. See you next time.